BBOR, Black Box Online Radio, coming to you from West Virginia. Black Box Ned 88 on Instagram for the bonus podcast. And just a quick reminder, every Monday is Zodiac Mondays. Wednesday is an Ask Me Anything. That's an AMA, so please drop your questions below for things that you would like discussed here on the show. And Friday is an Anything Goes. Any subject is fair game, mostly talking about true crime, serial killers, the Zodiac Killer, but any subject is welcome. All right, so please share some ideas in the comment section about what you would like to hear about on this channel, and let's get started. Okay, hello everybody. Today is New Year's Day, January 1st, so I hope everybody had a good New Year's last night. And today we're going to be talking about the 1967 murder of Nikki Benedict from Poway, California. We're going to introduce this subject in somewhat of a different way. Normally, I don't just read off large chunks of articles, or sometimes reading off the article in its entirety to introduce a case, but I think that that would be a very good way to go about this subject. So, the first one I would like to turn to is something that was actually written out by Missing Kids Rescued Kids. They did an excellent video on Nikki Benedict, but this is some of the writing that they have about it. And once again, we're going to Poway, California, which is in the southern part of the state. During the early evening hours of May 1st, 1967, 14-year-old Nikki Alexandra Benedict was walking home from a friend's house when she was critically stabbed and left to die in a field across from 12784 Poway Road in Poway, California. About 6:30 p.m., an 11-year-old boy discovered Nikki lying in the field. The boy immediately reported what he had discovered to his father, who owned a market nearby. Deputies from the Poway Sheriff's Station, the Poway Fire Department, and ambulance personnel responded to the scene. They rendered first aid and transported Nikki to Palomar Hospital in Escondido, where she was pronounced deceased upon arrival. The on-scene investigation showed evidence of a struggle a short distance from the location where Nikki was found. Anyone with information and the identity or location of the person slash persons responsible for this is asked to contact the Sheriff's Homicide Unit at 858-974-2321. Okay, that is what they have written out there, and there's some things that stand out immediately about that description, and you will hear a lot of things about Nikki Benedict online. First, we should say rest in peace to her, but people are going to try to connect the murder of Nikki Benedict to the murder of Sherry Jo Bates, which occurred in Riverside, California, about half a year earlier, more or less. I mean, Sherry Jo Bates was murdered on the 30th of October, 1966, and Nikki Benedict was murdered on the 1st of May, 1967, and both of them were stabbed, and both of them were just left discarded, meaning that the perpetrator did not try to move their body to a location. Like, for example, in the Santa Rosa hitchhiker slayings, we have the possibility of the perpetrator carrying the body of the deceased victim, perhaps 100 yards or and such. And I said we would go through some articles first just to read off to get an introduction, and we can see that not only is there a connection to Sherry Jo Bates and that murder in Riverside from 66, but people are going to be trying to link this case to the Zodiac Killer in its entirety. I mean, the mystery in its entirety, and saying that Nikki Benedict from Poway, California is indeed an overlooked Zodiac Killer victim. But the next article that we're going to go to is from SD Sheriff, and that's just their website there, sdsheriff.net, and they have one here that is written about Nikki Benedict. The San Diego County Sheriff's Homicide Detail is asking the public's help to find the person or persons responsible for the death of 14-year-old Nikki Benedict, who was found stabbed on a dirt road more than 45 years ago. During the early evening hours of May 1st, 1967, Nikki Benedict was walking home from a friend's house when she was critically stabbed and left to die on a dirt trail in the 12700 block of Poway at about 6:30 p.m. Now, the additional things that we can add in there, because we see the time frame, we also see that she's walking along this dirt road. Well, what is this? As I've been learning about this case, I found that what Nikki was doing was actually taking an somewhat of an unfamiliar shortcut to her, but it was definitely a shortcut. And believe it or not, when I look into this stuff, I was very skeptical of any type of Zodiac killer connection. I thought it was highly unlikely. I thought this is just, people pattern seeking and trying to force a pattern onto the situation. But as I began reading more and more, some things immediately jumped out at me. And that is that, number one, using a shortcut. And number two, the time of death when which this occurred. This was around 6:30 p.m. I mean, it's around 6:30 p.m. when the body is recognized by that 11-year-old boy, but thereabouts, I mean, thereabouts, like, the crime occurred just before 6:30 p.m. So firstly, the Zodiac killer committed a crime in the daytime at around 6:30 p.m. at Lake Berryessa. And the time 6:30 was written on the car door of Brian Hartnell's Carmen Ghia on September 27th of 1969. That was also a crime that was committed by knife, once again in the daylight. And when we look at May 1st, I'm in Southern California. Absolutely, there was daylight at that point. There was also daylight on September 27th. That is the only confirmed Zodiac incident that occurred in the daytime. And the only confirmed Zodiac incident that was murdered, that was a murder in which was committed by knife. So then that's another similarity. And the other thing that stood out to me was that this was an unfamiliar shortcut. And we've also talked before on the channel, especially in the episode that we did called the Faraday Jensen Murders. Actually, I think it's the Jensen Faraday Murders is the title of that one here on this channel. Always inviting you guys to listen to some content. Lake Herman Road, the first confirmed Zodiac victims, were going down a shortcut as well, although that wasn't a walking trail, that was a road. Like the parking lot at Lake Herman Road where David Faraday and Betty Lou Jensen were, was a shortcut as a way to get in between two towns, if from what I've been reading online has been correct. I have to confess, I'm not from California, I'm a West Virginian, a little bit far away. But those are just some other things that something about that just really got my attention, that you almost have somebody who is waiting in this shortcut area or prowling the area, patrolling the shortcuts and looking at when people are going to be in a vulnerable place. And even on the night of the Lake Herman Road murders, there's that possible vehicle that comes into the parking lot that sees two other teenagers earlier in the night, and one guy's working under the hood of a car, and then he sees this suspicious-looking vehicle, and for some reason he's bothered, so he just closes the hood of the car, gets in, and drives away, and the suspicious vehicle leaves the Lake Herman Road parking lot and follows him. So that just really made me think more about how Nikki Benedict was walking down this road that was which is just a dirt path, but it's this shortcut that she isn't very familiar with, and then this horrible tragedy happens to her. But the other thing though that reminded me of the murder of Sherry Jo Bates is Sherry Jo Bates is not a confirmed Zodiac killer victim, and Sherry Jo Bates is she was murdered by knife, but also it was done in a very reckless way. That was a very brutal but reckless crime all the same, in the sense that Sherry Jo Bates was stabbed numerous times. Many people believe that that was a revenge killing, that that was somebody going after Sherry Jo Bates, who was very well acquainted with her, or some type of former lover. I mean, and some people, of course, still insist to this day that it was Ross Sullivan who murdered Sherry Jo Bates, but it's also possible that Ross Sullivan was just a very odd and creepy individual who wasn't the most pleasant person to be around, but it's also possible that he was not a murderer at all. With Nikki Benedict, some of the things that people are saying about her is that even though she was only 14 at the time, I found a video clip online of her talking with or of her parents talking. I believe with some her mother is giving us some descriptions of her, and they were saying she was only 14 years old, but she was so passionate about causes, she was already becoming an activist, and they actually thought that she might even grow up to be an engineer, and she's talking about all of these things that she wanted to do. And I was reminded of something from my own experience back when I was in college, and I didn't know this one guy very well, but we went on this college trip together once, and other than riding in a car with him for 8 hours, I never really spent any other time with him. But aside from that, it was like I didn't know the guy that well. The next year, I found out that he had died in a car accident, and like two guys were drag racing on the road, and they one of them would crashed into his car head on, and he was killed. And when we had been on that car trip, as I said, you're sitting in a car with a guy for 8 hours. He's telling me about all of these things that he wants to do. I'm gonna be doing this project, and oh, I'm a musician. I got this other thing going on, and he's telling me about all of these creative and artistic things that he wants to do with his life. And a year later, I mean, he was killed in a car crash, and you just have that experience of like, wow, that person had so much so many dreams and ambition, unfulfilled dreams and ambition. And that's exactly what I thought about when I was hearing the stuff about Nikki Benedict. I mean, she apparently really wanted to be a very good force in the world, and she wanted to do many good things, and it seems like she had a very bright future ahead of her. It seems just saddening that that's an incident like this took place. But the other points that we have to note about Nikki Benedict is she was not sexually assaulted, meaning that this was someone who was trying to murder her in an opportunistic way, but not sexually assaulting the victim. And that is also a similarity that we find in the Zodiac Killer mystery. While we do have somewhat of a changing methodology going on with the Zodiac Killer, something about that also just got the gears turning a little bit, and I was like, what would be the motive then? What would be the reason why somebody would want to go after somebody like Nikki Benedict? I mean, just to murder a 14-year-old girl in an opportunistic way? Well, in the later part of this episode, we are definitely going to talk about some things, but I would actually like to go over to a different article because I said that we would use a couple different ones to start off the episode, and I'm going to go over to zodiaciphers.com. I use this website all the time. Big thank you to Richard and everybody who is affiliated with zodiaciphers.com. I think it's a I mean, I really like the way that they structure all of the material, and I'll say something else about them in a second, but I would like to read from this article here on zodiaciphers.com about the murder of Nikki Benedict. Nikki Alexandra Benedict had left her friend Kathy Gumsky's house in Halper Road, Poway, on May 1st, 1967, shortly after 6 p.m., to walk the 2.5 mile journey to her home at 13530 Olive Tree Lane. When approximately 25 minutes into her journey, her life was cruelly snatched. Think about that time frame again. 6:25 thereabouts, the crime would have taken place. 6:20 to 6:25. That is oddly similar to the time at Lake Berryessa. She was just passing the intersection of 12784 Poway and Carriage Road, traveling along a dirt pathway that had straddled the Poway Road, when a man laying in wait leapt from a grassy depression and viciously attacked the young teenage with a short teenage girl with a short bladed knife. She had a knife wound to her neck and bruises to her elbows and knees, but the fatal injuries were from two stab wounds that penetrated her heart. And you also see this here that she wasn't stabbed that many times. I have frequently said on the channel that Sherry Jo Bates was stabbed 42 times. I didn't pull that number out of thin air. I can't even remember where I learned that from, but somebody wrote into the channel saying that they had just read the autopsy report and that that number is incorrect. But it appears that a big difference between the Bates murder and the Nikki Benedict murder is that Nikki Benedict would have been stabbed in a much less vicious way. Now, when we look at Cecilia Shepherd and Brian Hartnell at Lake Berryessa, Brian Hartnell was stabbed either 6 or 7 times, and Cecilia Shepherd, of course, was stabbed 10 times. So those are much less than 42. Those definitely don't appear to be revenge killings. Those appear to be something more like an opportunistic murderer who is doing this in a power-tripping way. But the two fatal stab wounds were to her heart. The young girl did not succumb to her injuries immediately, also similar to Cecilia Shepherd, although I don't believe that was calculated by the murderer. I think that's just another similarity. And there was a trail of blood extending 200 yards to the west side of Carriage Road as she desperately sought help near a local shopping center. At approximately 6:30 p.m., an 11-year-old boy, Ronald Fisk, discovered the critically injured girl and raced away on his bicycle to seek help from his father, who worked at a nearby market store. Unfortunately, despite the best efforts of responding personnel, Nikki Benedict would be pronounced dead on arrival at Palomar Hospital. Nikki Benedict would usually travel the 2.3-mile journey from home to Meadowbrook Junior High School on the school bus. However, on this Monday, she visited her friend Kathy in Halper Road to discuss an art project. Kathy was planning to escort Nikki along the initial part of her journey, but was unable to accompany her friend because she was told to stay home for dinner. Nikki Benedict would have traveled south before heading east alongside the Poway Road toward home, or traveled southeast from Halper Road to the intersection of Poway and Carriage Road, near to where the body was discovered. Whether she had been trailed by her attacker or had walked into his path has yet to be fully determined. And I'm not going to lie to you guys, that was one thing that I was definitely thinking about. Like, well, how opportunistic was this? I mean, was there a specific reason why this perpetrator was targeting her? Was it something about physical appearance? I mean, we have very famous examples of that. Like, Ted Bundy would mostly choose his victims because they reminded him of an ex-lover who had rejected him. But, and this is something that I didn't mean to get too specific with the, you know, the examples, but the point is that serial killers often target their victims for somewhat of a specific reason. I mean, some people will simply just go after whoever is vulnerable, or they'll go after sex workers because they can get them to a vulnerable place. This is not the same thing that is happening here, because Nikki Benedict is, of course, just a 14-year-old girl who is walking down a dirt path. I was really wondering, like, how long was this perpetrator trailing her? Was he somebody who was doing more of what we said before, like, stalking the dirt path because it is a shortcut, and he knows that at some point somebody is going to come by, perhaps a female, and he is going to murder that individual? Or was there a larger reason that Nikki Benedict was targeted? Did her appearance remind him of somebody else, and that there was a specific reason why she was targeted? Or was this person just waiting for any girl to walk down that pathway? That one I can't even answer. I mean, this is an unsolved case, but that is definitely what I was thinking about. But there was no robbery or sexual interference. One eyewitness recalled a white man fleeing the scene. Although there are no solid suspects, people have subsequently emerged from this sighting, and the case has remained relatively trapped in time for just over 52 years. Now, we will say a big thing in part two about a suspect, and from the title here, you can see that his name will be Gareth Penn. And I learned about this case because I was on the YouTube channel Zodiac Killer Insights. Big shout out to Joe, who runs that channel, and he talks a lot about the Gareth Penn theory, meaning that Gareth Penn was the Zodiac Killer, more or less. And not only does he accuse Gareth Penn of being the Zodiac Killer, but of course murdering Sherry Jo Bates, as well as the murder of Nikki Benedict. Or, I mean, we'll say some about those things in the later part of this episode, because I want to keep going here, but I just wanted to point out that somebody does have a suspect for this murder. But I need to be 100% clear in my own right. I am not accusing Gareth Penn of this crime. That is someone else's accusation. But let's look here what Zodiac Ciphers has to say. Links have been forged to the Riverside murder of Sherry Jo Bates on October 30th, 1966, some 6 months earlier. 183 or 84 days, so I've heard. She, too, was savagely attacked with a short-bladed knife, with the Zodiac Killer belatedly laying claim to her murder on March 13th of 1971 when he wrote to the Los Angeles Times stating, "I do not have to give them credit for stumbling across my Riverside activity, but they are only finding the easy ones. There are a hell of a lot more down there. Poway, San Diego is 83 miles south of Terracina Drive in Riverside, where Sherry Jo Bates was ultimately discovered on Halloween, and by Riverside caretaker Cleophas Martin. I always find it helpful to provide a description of the crime scene." And so we have something here that has been shared by Zodiac Ciphers in regards to the murder of Nikki Benedict. And yes, actually, you know, she was about 1.65 miles from her home. And I'm sure you've thought about this too. Like, when you've been walking, I remember the first time I tried to walk, like, from a 2 mile marker to, you know, the destination that I was going. And I was quite surprised that it took about 45 solid minutes. You know, it's something that would have taken her a substantial amount of time. But, I mean, if it's in the daylight and it's 6:30 p.m. in May, I mean, that's not an easy walk. She wouldn't arrive in 10 minutes or anything. It probably would have taken her about an hour to complete all this. But, I mean, it's definitely something within reason. Now, what I would really want to do is to talk more about the Gareth Penn connection to this. So we will have one quick message and then we will get to that material right away, okay? So please stay tuned. Be back after this. Bum ba bum 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 ba bum 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 ba bum bum bum. At this time, I would like to talk about some of the ways in which you can help Black Box Online Radio. This channel relies on your support, and the best way you can help out is just by listening to some more content. If you like what you hear, you can hit that like button, subscribe, and share with your friends on social media. But I should also say that Black Box Online Radio now has a Teespring page, and there will be some links in the description box. Please feel free to check out some of the merchandise that is available. Almost all sizes and colors are listed. So, you can also help out by going over to the Zodiac Killer channel and watching the documentary series Obsession Into Darkness, Parts 1, 2, and 3. I was one of the contributors for that, and you can see some other great Zodiac content on the Zodiac Killer channel. And yes, there will be a Part 4 of Obsession Into Darkness at some point in the future. And for now, let's get back to the show. And hello, yes, we are back. So if we're going to look at Nikki Benedict, and we need to say some things about a couple suspects in her murder. One of them is Gareth Penn, who is not only a suspect, but he's also more famous for being a researcher and the author of the book Time 17, which was looking at an individual named Michael Henry O'Hare, also known as MHOH, as the Zodiac Killer, and he was really trying to use the angles of mathematical signatures in the Zodiac world, and really trying to show that there is something that a lot of people overlooked, that the Zodiac had an enormously high understanding of mathematics. But how would all of this relate to the murder of Nikki Benedict as well as the murder of Sherry Jo Bates? But I mean, before we get into that, I should say we need to bear in mind that the Zodiac did take responsibility for 37 murders, and is it possible that Nikki Benedict is just one of the individuals that the Zodiac murdered and didn't report in the conventional way that, like 1968 and 69, this murderer is just putting on a persona? He is just committing these crimes under the name Zodiac for a particular year, and in other years, like 1966 and 67, this individual is committing crimes in a different way, and that it's all tied together and linked through mathematics. Well, where are people getting this stuff? Why would all of these crimes be connected through mathematics? Well, to give credit to Joe from Zodiac Killer Insights, he actually contacted Gareth Penn, just called him up out of the blue, and it's one of the few times when you actually get to hear somebody talking to their Zodiac suspect. Yes, of course, other people have done it, absolutely. You can even find some of that stuff here on YouTube. But it's always a good opportunity when the other person gets to give their side of the story. And with Gareth Penn, there is the connection to the number 184. Now, please, I'm open to correction if I've misunderstood something. But you can anyone can share something in the comments section. But the way it seems to follow is, if you add up the numeric values of Gareth Penn's name, Gareth Sewell Penn, like we're talking about numeric value, meaning that the letter G is the seventh letter of the alphabet. That's a seven, and A is the first letter of the alphabet. So 7 plus 1 is what? 8, right? But then R is the 18th letter of the alphabet, so 8 plus 18 equals 26, and then so on. If you had to add up all of those numeric values, his name comes out to 184. And the murder of Nikki Benedict took place 184 days after Sherry Jo Bates. Once again, Sherry Jo Bates, October 30th, 1966, and then Nikki Benedict, May 1st, 1967. 184 days later. So this is all lining up in a mathematical fashion. And this would also explain why the perpetrator would have murdered Sherry Jo Bates, as well as, I mean, it explains that 2-year gap from Riverside to Lake Herman Road, 1968, December 20th of 1968 to be precise, that actually there isn't a 2-year gap. This person is committing murders in a more frequent fashion, so that answers a lot of questions about why so few. Well, actually, there aren't so few. There are other murders. They're just happening in a very calculated way. And the next thing, though, to say is, When Joe confronted Gareth Penn about this, he adamantly denied it. He said that he's even talked to the San Diego sheriff's office, someone from San Diego County named Will Altenhoff, who was mentioned in some of the other articles about the murder of Nikki Benedict. He appears to be the primary investigator. And Gareth Penn's response is, there are not 184 days in between the murder of Sherry Jo Bass October 30th and the murder of Nikki Benedict on May 1st. There are 183, and by Gareth Penn's own advice, you can even do it on your own calculator, 365 plus 121 minus 303 equals 183 days. So it appears that you have to count the 30th of October in that, like, the day Sherry Jo Bass was murdered to the day Nikki Benedict was murdered. And and somebody said in the comments section, both possibilities work. If you include the date of October 30th, there are 184. If you do not, there are 183. But one point that would support Gareth Penn's innocence in that is that 184, I mean, if you're going to say that October 30th is the day, yes, Sherry Jo Bass was attacked and murdered outside of the RCC library, and she was found on Halloween morning, October 31st, by a custodian or maintenance worker of sorts, someone of a similar occupation. But the issue with that is that she was murdered very close to midnight, definitely after dark, somewhere in the vicinity of 9:30, 10 p.m., 11 p.m., somewhere in the later parts of the day, so there barely would have been any time on the 30th of October. I mean, just a handful of hours before she would have been murdered, so it's definitely not a full day. I can give Gareth Penn credit to that, so saying that, yeah, it almost works, but it is just falling short. And Gareth Penn's other rebuttal to this is just very simple. He's saying, you cannot use this type of material, like looking at like the days of someone's like numeric value and how does this all tie in mathematically, and to say that, oh, well, if we count up the numeric value of your name and look at how many days are in between two murders, it's not going to be anything that you could use in a court of law. And Gareth Penn has been accused of being the Zodiac Killer and committing murders many times, it seems. I mean, Ray Grant also perhaps had some things to say about Gareth Penn and his involvement in the Zodiac Killer mystery. And there's some other people out there that even say that Gareth Penn's father, Hugh Penn, was involved to this in a greater extent. And we did that when we were looking at the website ZodiacRevisited.com. So what is all this about? I mean, how does Gareth Penn respond to this? He says, look at the biometrics. Those are the things that you can bring into a court of law, saying that he has a size 12 boot print, a size 12 shoe, and that would be quite different than the 10.5 prints that were found after the stabbing at Lake Berryessa with Cecilia Shepherd and Brian Hartnell. Now, with the incident that took place in Riverside, I believe that it's estimated to be around a size 9 to a size 10.5, meaning they aren't 100% certain, but then he's like, well, that doesn't fit his dimensions either. And after the murder of Nikki Benedict, we have a Caucasian male seen leaving the area, which, as I understand, is just some guy is walking by in the area who seems very hurried, but he was leaving the area in which Nikki Benedict should have been. And they do have those boot prints or footprints from the area in which the struggle would have taken place. And they said that those were 10.5. Gareth Penn also would not match up to that if he had a size 12 shoe. And Gareth Penn's also provided the things that he was fingerprinted twice when he was in the United States military, as well as being a government employee, and they couldn't cross-reference those fingerprints anytime to the ones after the Stein shooting, as well as, I mean, the Zodiac was very adamant that he did not leave fingerprints, but I think what Gareth Penn is trying to say is, I mean, they have an enormous amount of info on him that people could use, not only fingerprints, but also talking about the characteristics of the physical evidence may not match up to Gareth Penn. But, I mean, you know, like, I would love to just sit down with somebody like Gareth Penn and just We don't even have to talk about the Zodiac Killer. Just talk about numbers and such in the language of the universe. I mean, I think he would be re a really good person to do that because when he's being interrogated on Zodiac Killer Insights about this stuff, he's like, "Hey, there are 184 days in between the murder of Sherry Joe Bates and Nikki Benedict," and off the top of his head, he's just like, "No, they're not. They're 183." And 365 plus 121 minus 303 is 183 days. Like, and I think everybody was who watched that, including Joe himself, was just like, "Well, you seem to know that pretty quickly." He's like, "Yeah, I've talked about it in the past," but also he just has such a good handle on mathematics. And I said this in our book discussion on time 17. If you want to go back and listen to that, even if Gareth Penn's theory about Michael O'Hare having any involvement in those crimes is incorrect, Time 17 is an impressive work of mathematical creativity, and I mean, maybe even the Time 17 itself isn't so much what Gareth Penn made it out to be, saying that that is one of the names or signatures of the perpetrator. There are two significant numbers in that book, 17 and 38, and he's saying that the Zodiac has this connection to that, and it counts up like, well, he just finds a way to link it all together in a very impressive usage of mathematical creativity, even if it's not 100% what actually happened in history. I'm impressed with what Gareth Penn had created in that book, and you can hear more about that here on the channel Black Box Online Radio. We have a 6-part book discussion on Time 17 by Gareth Penn. But aside from all of that, I really have to insist I do not believe that Gareth Penn was the Zodiac Killer, because not only is it talking about like a size 12 shoe versus a size 10 and a half, I mean, I think it's a good story. But at the same time, where is the physical evidence that would actually connect him to the crimes? As well as stating that, I mean, I think it's a very large stretch to try and connect him to something like the murder of Nikki Benedict in Poway, California, because, I mean, you would have to place him at the scene, then you would have to have a much larger explanation than just this type of mathematical signature. I know that it sounds like a good story, but even if you're going to say that there are 184 days in between Sherry Joe Bates and Nikki Benedict, the Zodiac Killer was accused of an enormous amount of crimes. There's also an accusation that the Zodiac was involved with an attempted abduction of a Riverside co-ed 3 weeks after the murder of Sherry Joe Bates in November of 1966. How would that fit in to the mathematical calculations and support the theory that this is all some giant mathematical puzzle that has been put together by an individual? I mean, that has no relevance to 184. Is it 184 hours after the murder of Sherry Joe Bates? I mean, it's like, I can see where people are coming from, but that is almost an insufficient way of going about it. Like, it's an ineffective way of going about it, and the evidence is always going to be insufficient because then you're like, okay, well, you can play around with numbers so easily, but that doesn't mean that somebody committed a murder. I mean, no matter what your name is, we can probably count up the value of, the numeric value of your name, and you can probably plug it into something in the Zodiac Killer mystery and find out that the numbers match up, and it's sort of like the movie The Number 23 with Jim Carrey et al., except hopefully not as cheesy. And I think that I just have to be very clear. I do not believe that Gareth Penn was the Zodiac Killer or that he murdered anybody, but I'm always open to new possibilities and evidence, and I want to keep hearing about what Zodiac Killer Insights has to say because I think it's a very well-done channel, and maybe I'll be proven wrong and I'll learn something new. But we will keep discussing this after this quick message here. Bum ba bum 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 ba bum 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 ba bum bum bum. At this time, I would like to remind everybody about YouTube Premium. If you use the YouTube Premium features, you can download Black Box Online Radio, take it on the go, out walking, in the car, anywhere and anyhow. YouTube Premium also gives you access to special YouTube original shows and YouTube music. And now, let's get back to the episode. Okay, hello, and we are going to go to a different piece of material now, and that is from the YouTube channel Zodiac Killer Identified. And that must ring a few bells for you. If not, this is the guy that talks a lot about Don Hardin being the Zodiac Killer. I think his name is Zepp, But he makes some good videos. What I would like to do with this one is I would like to sort of walk through the video that he has made about the murder of Nikki Benedict from 1967, and we can see some things that he has to say. If you do ever watch this video, which I do recommend to you, is called Zodiac Killer Identified, Use of It and But, Also Nikki Benedict 1967 Murder Suspect. So let's see what he has to say here. When I said I'm going to walk through it, his video does not have sound, so I'll read off some things. Nikki Benedict, age 14, was stabbed to death and found in a field near the owner of a meat market business. Okay, that's the first thing. And she was actually witnessed walking through the parking lot of the meat market that day. But as we said, of course, she was taking that shortcut, walking down the dirt path. And I think he's going to explore the possibility of how the meat market could be much more significant to the case than a lot of other people have been leading on, and that there could actually be something going on there. And we also have to say, as we said from the Zodiac Ciphers article, the first person that found her was that boy, 11 years old, named Ronald Fisk. Was this a victim of opportunity? Nobody's here. Let's just close the shop for a few minutes. And a lot of people just wonder how criminals think. A lot of people just wonder how these serial perpetrators operate when they want to be like, do they just see somebody in a vulnerable place and do they go after them? The concept of being an opportunistic perpetrator, and I'm sure that must happen sometimes. When somebody just sees someone and they think they can do something very destructive and get away with it. Is that exactly what happened here? I'm not 100% sure. But let's keep going with what they have to see. Because he has now shared something with us that is talking about the owner of the shop. And this is, says, at interview, Bob Fisk and his son Ronald talked to the Chieftain reporters late Monday night at their home. And he has two people in a photograph. One is Bob Fisk, and the other is Ronald. As we said, Ronald was the one who found Nikki Benedict's body. So already you can see the foundations of how he is going to introduce his next suspect. There is something they say in the true crime world about how the person who has found the body or the last person to see somebody alive could be could usually have a much larger role than what originally appears. The next slide says, there were actually three girls stabbed to death in fields all near Bob Fisk's meat market in Poway. So he is proposing a new suspect, and that is Bob Fisk for the murder of Nikki Benedict, and proximity, location, as well as completely going against everything that we said about Gareth Penn, that this is some giant mathematical masterpiece. Instead, this is just somebody who is murdering people in the vicinity of his area and not leaving an enormous amount of evidence behind, and then that is how he got away with it. I'm not accusing Bob Fisk of anything. This is just some stuff that's written on the YouTube channel here. The knife used on Nikki Benedict came from knives sold at the meat market. Talking about Bob Fisk's meat market in Poway. Now, this is the first time that I've read that, and we also read through those other two articles here, as well as watching other YouTube videos online. That is the first time I heard this here. I'm not sure the source of that the knife used on Nikki Benedict came from the knives that was sold in the meat market. But Zodiac Killer Identified has written that in here. Once again, I'm not exactly sure of the source for that. And I think that's a bit of a, they definitely say that it's a short-bladed knife. That's the thing that gets repeated a lot. But I don't necessarily know where he's getting that from. The next slide says, if you are a butcher and you are spotted with blood on your apron, nobody's going to question you. Well, we did say, though, that there was that male individual that was seen exiting the scene, or there was that male individual that was seen in the area who seemed like he was running away from something, who was described as being a Caucasian who should have been close to Nikki Benedict. I do not believe that anybody said that he was wearing any type of butcher's apron. If you are a butcher and you are spotted with blood on your apron, nobody's going to question you. This is one theory that gets used in the true crime world time and time again. They even talk about this stuff with Jack the Ripper, that that's the way that these murders were committed, those murders were committed, excuse me, in England in 1888, because, well, it must have been a butcher, someone who would have blood on their clothes and no one would question, or wearing a butcher's apron. And there's even a theory out there called the Jill the Ripper theory, that it was a midwife, like someone who was involved with giving birth to children, and or like helping a woman deliver the baby, and she had blood on her clothes and aprons, and that was the justification that Jack the Ripper was a woman, and it's actually Jill the Ripper. This gets used time and time again, even in the Black Dahlia case, where I mean, that is an alternative theory, of course. I don't subscribe to that. I definitely lean more toward George Hill Hodel being the perpetrator in that one. But what's that other crime that's attributed to George Hill Hodel from like Illinois, when they talk about how a butcher would have had the knowledge to have committed that murder? But I don't even want to go down that pathway too much, because I'm getting somewhat sidetracked. The point is, though, butchers often become the suspects. The thing that would support that is butchers have an enormous familiarity with knives, about how to cut between cartilage and bone and all of those things. But now here's another point that in the next slide, a lady who knew Bob Fisk said that he would shake her hand and squeeze it so hard she thought it was going to break. Some people have very firm handshakes, actually, and some people think it's quite a turnoff when someone has a limp handshake. I'm not too impressed by that, but I am impressed, though, that Zodiac Killer Identified is even just trying to make a solid attempt to identify a suspect, being in the vicinity of the area. And even though I'm somewhat critical of just blaming the butcher, it doesn't seem like it's completely impossible, unless we learn some other information later on. Now, it says on the next page that it sounds like he, referring to Bob Fisk, liked women and little girls. Well, part of me is just like, okay, I get it. You're describing that awkward encounter with a woman, saying that, okay, there must be some type of psychological element going on there as an undertone. I follow you there, but it sounds like he liked women and little girls. This is the first thing that we've heard about Bob Fisk liking little girls. Like, once again, where are you getting that source material from? I'm not necessarily sure. Everything else you've said is just that there has been a series of crimes that were committed in the vicinity of his butcher shop, the meat market. But what does that have to do with Robert Fisk having any type of interaction with girls? I'm just not certain. And also, it is Ronald Fisk, the son, who found Nikki Benedict's body and ran back to the meat market to report it in, not Bob. But there has been another suspect that has been put forward by Zodiac Killer Identified. I really thought he was going to say that Don Harden was the suspect. I thought that would be a little bit more unlikely, but I do appreciate it when people are making a fair attempt to try and solve a mystery, that they have a suspect and they have a theory. And I did this countless times on the internet, putting forward a case about, here's what I think happened. And this is all stuff from the 1960s, and I think that it's a little bit difficult, but it's also people are just trying to figure out what happened. So I commend that from Zodiac Killer Identified, and from Joe from Zodiac Killer Insights. Even though it appears that I'm not 100% convinced of either of these two suspects, and it seems like somebody, I mean, we would really have to have an answer to that question. Was this crime committed as a very, very personal and calculated opportunity, where somebody is stalking Nikki Benedict for a very long time? Or is this person simply just waiting in the brush, more or less, for someone to come by in a vulnerable place? And I don't think without an answer to that question, we can finally figure out who murdered Nikki Benedict. And that's just in terms of looking at information that is available to armchair detectives. Another way to go about this is, if somebody knows who did it, or somebody has figured out who committed this crime, or perhaps a deathbed confession would lead people down the pathway to getting the truth and getting answers for Nikki Benedict's family. One more time, we'll say rest in peace to Nikki Benedict. I thank anybody who's listened to the entirety of this episode, and I want to be very clear. I do respect those guys for putting out their theories, even though I seem to disagree with them. And I hope that we can get some truth that will come to the surface, and we'll get answers about what happened to Nikki Benedict. But if you like this upload, you can hit the like button, and if you haven't subscribed yet, you're welcome to do so. But most importantly, please drop some comments below, and see you on Instagram for the bonus podcast. Until next time.